So Washington has just 5 weeks to hammer out a deal on the debt ceiling, but the two sides are still very far apart, and some analysts say that they're playing with fire on this one. Robert Greenstein is the founder and president of the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities and joins us this morning from Washington. Sir, it's good to have you on. I want to get straight to the timeline about this, because at what point does this standoff start having real impact on the markets and the greater economy?
You know, that no one knows for certain. We have to raise the debt limit by about August 2nd.
Right.
But if the markets at any point before then start to feel that we're really not going to get it done and that we're actually going to default, then I think the markets will start reacting. Up till now, the markets have assumed that despite all the political skirmishing, eventually it'll get done. But with the walkout of the Republican negotiators last week and their hard line on raising any money, even by closing tax loopholes, it's not quite certain that this is actually going to get done.
And Robert, this is the extended date of August 2nd that just bought everybody more time. New polling, though, from the AP is showing that the public is divided on whether to raise the limit. 41% oppose the idea, 38% are in favor. But take a look at this, though. A majority of people expect an economic crisis to happen if the debt ceiling is not raised. And among them, 37% are still opposed. So when we look at this, are people out there really understanding what's out there looming as we approach this date of August 2nd?
I think there are two things that are not well understood. One is that if we default, even if it's just for, say, a week, that could add huge amounts to the deficit and the debt in the future, because people at home and abroad who loan money to the U.S. government could demand higher interest rates to cover the risk that they might not be paid in full or on time. The second is, I think many Americans misunderstand and think that raising the debt limit is like taking more money on your credit card. In fact, we need to raise the debt limit just to pay off the obligations we've already incurred. For example, if we were to enact, and hopefully we will not, the really draconian cuts in Paul Ryan's budget, we would still have to raise the debt limit by $7 trillion over the next decade because of various obligations already incurred. I don't think that's well understood.
Robert, does the international community smell blood in the water, so to speak, because the rating agencies have been sounding alarms now for months? So has that impact already lost standing when it comes to the U.S. and the global marketplace?
I don't think so. I think that the warnings are that if the United States doesn't appropriately raise the debt limit now, and if over the next several years we don't begin to put in place measures to put ourselves back on a sustainable fiscal course after the economy recovers, then you'll see all kinds of reactions. But I think at the present time, the international markets still assume we'll get our act together, we'll get the debt limit raised. And they're giving us more time to get our fiscal house in order, in part, I think, because most people who really know the issues understand that if we did big budget cuts right now while the unemployment rate is at 9%, we'd run the risk of putting ourselves back into another recession, and that would make deficits even higher. Right. This is the irony, is we need to actually do more things now to help the economy on a temporary basis, and then we need strong medicine in the midterm and the long term to get our fiscal house back in order.
Robert, let's explore that more, because the two big issues at play right now are the tax revenues, the spending cuts. Can the government cut its way to fiscal stability, or have taxes? Have they got to be on the table for this one to work?
Well, you know, it's almost even a false distinction, because we have over $1 trillion a year in spending, in subsidies that are delivered through the tax code. Big subsidies to oil corporations, subsidies to people who own corporate jets, all kinds of big loopholes for various sorts of Wall Street traders who pay taxes at lower rates on the millions they earn than ordinary Americans pay. These things are considered by analysts to really be spending, to really be government subsidies. They're just delivered through the code. We spend more money on those kinds of subsidies, on spending through the tax code each year, than we do on Social Security, on Medicare, and so forth. What I think the president and some of the Democratic negotiators have been pushing in the negotiations is that those subsidies that are delivered through the tax code and disproportionately benefit powerful corporations and people at the top of the income scale, that if Medicare and Medicaid and education and veterans benefits are going to be on the table, that those kinds of subsidies need to be on the table as well. And when Cantor and Senator Kyle walked out last week, they were effectively saying, no, that can't be on the table. And if those things aren't on the table, then I don't think you'll see Democrats agreeing to various kinds of changes in, you know, very basic issues from education to funding for clean water and environmental protection. You got to get everything on the table to get a big package.
Do you see this coming to fruition by August the 2nd or us defaulting?
I'm not sure. I don't think we'll default. I think it's possible that they will not have worked it out and that they will raise the debt limit for a few months and continue to fight about it and negotiate over it into the fall. Alternatively, they may work something out. It's really unclear at this point, and I think it really depends primarily on to what degree do the Republican leaders really want to be hostage takers and take us up to the brink, and to what degree they will be willing to move, as I think most Americans would want them to be, on some of the unproductive tax loopholes, particularly for powerful, profitable corporations and people at the top of the income scale. You can't really ask the poorest Americans to sacrifice, which is at the core of some of the things the Republican leaders are pushing, and then say loopholes for people at the top are sacrosanct.
Robert, and then we'll get through this, and then we'll have next year to look forward to, right? Robert Greenstein, good to have you on this morning. Thanks so much.
My pleasure to be here.